post the link of these lectures on your group so that you can also access later on. So this is my second session and second lecture on EBS, and you guys have to go for this one. So friends, once again I welcome you all for the second lecture, and here we are going to talk about wherever we guys have stopped. Wherever we guys have stopped, from that particular point onwards I'm going to start your session. So here is the PPT. Where is the PPT? Here is the PPT. And I hope whatever I taught you in the last lecture that you guys have understood. So this is our second lecture actually, and in last lecture we guys have talked about this start to spare, and we were about to discuss the second one, which is called as thermosphere. So we are just going through the concept of environment, and you know, we are talking about different elements and different factors, different conditions of environment, if I'm not wrong. So friends, I request you all to tell me this, whether my screen and voice is clear. Am I audible properly or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what I told you, answer quickly so that I can go in a quicker manner. Okay, so in last session, we guys have seen the definition, we guys have seen the concept of stratosphere, and now we are going to talk about the second element or second factor or second concept of environment, which is called as thermosphere. As the name reflects, everything it is thermosphere. So so what is there in thermosphere, that also we are going to discuss here. So first of all, I'm going to explain whatever things are there in the slide. After that I will show you by using the graph where is the thermosphere. So see, if you look at the concept of thermosphere, we can understand. This is what I have written, some points here. I will explain those points first, and later on I'll go for the next one. Temperature increases rapidly with increasing height. So see what happens when we go higher and higher and above, automatically the temperature will increase. So see, if you look at the bottom to top, if you look at this particular diagram, if you look at this particular, you know, picture, you can also understand, as we guys have seen this troposphere, then we have seen this stratosphere, and if you look at the last one, that is thermosphere, is here. So what they have said in the first point, temperature increases rapidly with the increase in height. When we increase the height, automatically temperature is also increased. This is what they say. When we go how above and above, higher and higher, we can experience the high temperature. And if you look at the thermosphere, that is at the top side that you can see here, which is written by, you know, white words or white color. So what does it mean? If you go to see that thermosphere, where the temperature is very high over there, then heating of this layer is due to absorption of solar energy. Why that is, you know, why there is a huge temperature? Because it is very close to solar, it is very close to sun, and this is what, there is a huge temperature. The reason behind having more temperature over there is what? It is you know, very close to sun, and it is very close to solar energy, and this is what, it is always heating, it is always heat, or it is always hot. Then within the thermosphere there is a layer of charged particles known as ionosphere. In that thermosphere only, there is one particular layer which is called as ionosphere, and that particular ionosphere contains some particles which are there from the environment, and that particles layer, which is also called as what, ionosphere. So where is that ionosphere? Ionosphere is there in the thermosphere. In the thermosphere only there is one particular layer, tithe kasa vegra asa thar asto, yala apan ionosphere asa manto. So this is the concept of thermosphere. So what you guys have to understand from the thermosphere, thermosphere is at the top side of the environment, it is very close to sun, it is very close to solar energy, and this is what, heating rate is more, heating is more, or it will be more hotter than the other spheres. then here temperature is always in increasing nature, and there is one particular layer which is called as ionosphere, which we use in that you can see in thermosphere. So this is for thermosphere. I hope you guys have understood. Then moving on to the next one, and there we are going to talk about exosphere. And what is this exosphere? That also we are going to see. Where it is exosphere that I am going to show you by using this. I think the exosphere they have not shown here, but no worry, I will explain you. It exists above the ionosphere and extend up to 2000 kilometers above the Earth. It is, you know, normally 2000 kilometers above the Earth. If you look, if you take an example of Earth, so it is 2000 kilometer above or up from the Earth, and it is above the ionosphere also. In last slide we guys have seen ionosphere, so it is above the ionosphere. And where what I told you, ionosphere is the part of thermosphere. So when it comes to exosphere, it is little bit above to the ionosphere, and it is 2000 kilometers above from the Earth. So this may ask for the objectives in your examination. This layer is almost airless and empty. This particular layer, there is no air as such, and there is no, you know, chance for having an air. It is totally empty. When it comes to having an air or not, in exosphere, there is no air as such, and this is what, there is no possibility of human beings or tree and plants over there, because we want, means for every sort of human beings, we need air. So air is not there in this exosphere. Then it contains hydrogen gas in ionized state. So in this particular sphere, which is called as exosphere, there is hydrogen gas, and which is in ionized format or ionized state. Very high temperature. When it comes to exosphere, as I told you, it is just above to the ionosphere, and this is what the temperature is very high at this particular sphere or at this particular stage, which is called as exosphere. And normally, 12,000 Celsius is the temperature over there, or more than 12,000 Celsius is the temperature at this particular layer. So this is for exosphere. If you guys have gone through this, and I hope you guys have understood this one. Then from this figure you can understand different levels and different, you know, what do we call it, different layers which are there in the atmosphere. And I request you all to go through this, and from that you can understand what is there in the environment. Just for the name, just for the sake of knowledge purpose, I have kept this picture for you guys. Then now we are going to understand what is this hydrosphere. This one is one more layer in the environment, which is called as hydrosphere. So what is hydrosphere that I'm going to tell you, that I'm going to explain you here in this particular slide. So just go through this. So what I have written here that I'm going to explain you for you all. About 70% of Earth is covered by water. As we know that if you bifurcate the land and water on the planet Earth, as we all are aware that on this planet Earth, or on Earth, the portion of land and water is divided like this. 70% of water is there, and only 30% is the land portion that we know very well. Kshetrapaiki 70% pani ani tishtate zamin, that we have totally aware with this. Then water is available in seas. Where we can see the water? Water is available in different sources, such as seas means oceans. We call it in Marathi Samudra. Oceans means Mothe Samudra. And lakes, rivers, glaceries, etc. Here we can see the water. So these are the sources of water where we can see the water easily available. Then next one, 90% is in the ocean and seas. Whatever water we see around us, out of those water, 97% water is available in the seas and in the oceans. Listener, hello? Huh? मला आठवतच नाही फोन करायचा, मी लेक्चर करतोय, माझ्या नंबरवर फोन करायचा, मोबाईल नंबरवर 8 0 6 7 8 9 2 3 म्हणून. lecture mein rehta hu. Okay, so if you look at the percentage of water which is available in different sources, if you want to see the percentage in terms of percentage, as far as the 100% of water available on the planet, out of that 90% water is available in the oceans and seas. एकूण पाण्याच्या उपलब्धतेपैकी 97% पाणी हे फक्त समुद्रामध्येच आणि काय म्हणतो आपण सागरामध्येच आहे. 2% इन ग्लॅशियर्स अँड आईस कॅप्स, 1% इज फ्रेश वॉटर अवेलेबल फॉर ह्युमन कन्झम्पशन. सो आउट ऑफ 100% वॉटर ओनली 1% वॉटर इज अवेलेबल ऑर इज सुटेबल ऑर यूजफुल फॉर वॉट ह्युमन कन्झम्पशन दॅट वी कॅन कन्झ्युम. So see, this one is just percentage of water, and here we have seen that in hydrosphere. So in hydrosphere, what we have seen that I will tell you. As far as this hydrosphere is concerned, here they have given the bifurcation of land and water on the planet Earth, and the percentage of water is 70%, and the percentage of land is 30%. Then water is available in different forms, in the form of sea, in the form of ocean, in the form of lakes, river and glaciers. It means what? We can see there are different sources of water like seas, oceans, lakes, rivers and glaciers. Then 97% is the ocean and seas. Whatever water we see around us, out of that 97% is there in the ocean and seas. 2% that we can see in glaciers and ice caps, and 1% that we can see as fresh water that we can consume usually, and that is suitable to consume, no issue. Then lithosphere is the third one. Lithosphere is what? That is one more layer in the environment that we are going to see here in this slide. Outer soil crust of the earth is lithosphere. So see what happened here. Outer soil crust of the earth is lithosphere. Lithosphere is the concept that we can part of lithosphere. Then living organism, plant, vegetation are supported by the lithosphere. So not only a soil crust is the part of lithosphere, other things are also there which are the part of lithosphere. Who are they and what are they? Just look at this. Living organism, that means we all, those who are living on the planet Earth, those can be called as living organism. Plant vegetation, whatever plants we can see around us, those are all the part of lithosphere also. So in lithosphere, what we can include soil crust, living organisms, plant vegetation, so on. Next one, it contains resources like minerals. It not only contains soil crust and organism and plant vegetation, it also contains resources like minerals, organic and inorganic matters, some extent air and water, so that we can easily contain here. The role of lithosphere, what sort of role that lithosphere has to play, that we can see. Produces food for human being and animals. So what is the role of that? Why it is important? Because it is very much important, because it produces, or this particular lithosphere produces food for human beings and animals. Lithosphere is nothing but what? Land, where we can say in Marathi, or आपण जमीन मराठी मध्ये जमीन म्हणतो, त्या पर्टिक्युलर थराला जमीन, ज्याच्यामध्ये जमीन, दगड, विटा, माती, थोडेसे टेकड्या, पर्वत, या थराला आपण काय म्हणतोय? लिथोस्फेअर. अँड वॉट इट इज इम्पॉर्टंट, बिकॉज वॉट एव्हर वी डू दॅट ऑन द पर्टिक्युलर लिथोस्फेअर, we go for agriculture, we go for staying, we construct our houses, we take through crops and all, that is on the lithosphere only. Soil is the site of decomposition of organic waste. So here they have said soil is the site of decomposition of organic waste. Whatever organic waste we use in our day to day life, that we can decompose in the soil, and by using that we can go for the lithosphere. So lithosphere is nothing but what? The land we can see around us, the land that we use for agriculture purpose, the land that we use for staying purpose or constructing houses purpose, that particular land is called as the lithosphere. So this is the concept of lithosphere. I hope you guys have understood. And now we are going to see the next concept, that is biosphere. Biosphere we are going to talk now. So what is biosphere? That also I'm going to tell you. Thin outer crust of the earth which includes all the living organisms and their environment. Thin. See, what does it mean by thin and thick? There are two words that we always use. Thin means what? A small one. Thick means what? A broad one. So see, thin outer crust of the earth, which includes all the living organisms and the environment. So this one is just a thin outer crust of our earth, and it includes living organisms and the environment. It extends from the lowest seabed level to about 40 kilometers of the atmosphere. Actually, it starts from the lowest seabed level and up to 24 kilometers of the atmosphere. Life supporting resources are available from the biosphere. Whatever life supporting resources we see around us, those are available on the biosphere. And the last one, it is the part of the earth where living biotic organism exit and interact with each other and also with non-living abiotic components. So in this last sentence, we can see there are two types of organisms, or there are two types of components that we are going to see in this coming lectures. Biotic and abiotic components. Biotic means what? What we call it? Living organism, and non-biotic, abiotic means what? Non-living organism. So these are the two types of organisms that we can use in, that we can have in biosphere. So this one is just a concept of biosphere you guys have to remember, and it may be asked for the MCQ in your final exam. So this is what we guys have seen, the concept of biosphere here. I hope you guys understood. Moving on to the next one, and there we are going to see the activities in biosphere. What sort of activities can be conducted, or what sort of activities are there when we go for activities under biosphere. So there are different activities we can conduct here, and what are they and which are they, just go through this. The living organism interacting with each other in biosphere and sustain their life. So whatever living organisms are there on the planet Earth, on the biosphere, that they interact with each other and they live there or sustain their life. We all are doing the same things, and we are the part and parcel of this biosphere. Whatever plants we see around us, whatever animals we see around us, those are the part and parcel of biosphere, including we people. The next one, the waste products in gases, liquid and solid form are discharged in biosphere. As far as the waste products are concerned, different types of gases, liquid and solid form are discharged in the biosphere. So this biosphere discharges a number of things like gases, liquid and solid form. So both are, or both can be discharged. Then sustaining and assimilative capacity of the biosphere is tremendous but not infinite. As far as the capacity of the biosphere is concerned, it is very, you know, assimilative and indefinite capacity they have. The system is in operation for millions of years but now showing stress due to impact of human on environment. Actually, this system is very, biosphere is very good and very, you know, interesting, but it is hampered by the human intervention, and human beings are trying to, you know, damage the nature, or, you know, intervene in the nature, and this is what it is, little bit, you know, collapsed, and this is what this biosphere is, a little bit damaged by the human beings because of their behavior, which is not good for the environment as such. So in this also we guys have seen something different about activities in biosphere. I hope you guys have understood those things in this particular slide. Now here we can see the concept of biosphere, how it is. If you look at the diagram, actually this one is a little bit, you know, blur, but I will explain you. So if you look at the first circle, that is biosphere where we guys are living. Then this one is atmosphere that we can see, which is the part of air. Then if the sea that we can see, though the water, the portion of water which is called as hydrosphere. And the last one, that is earth that we can see, that is called as what? Lithosphere. So in simple term, if I want to tell you, whatever air portion that we can see, that is called as atmosphere. Then whatever portion that we can see in the water, that is called as hydrosphere. And whatever portion that we can see on the land, on planet Earth, That is called as what? Lithosphere. So water, hydrosphere, air, atmosphere, and earth means land, lithosphere. Now the concept of this particular biosphere is over, and the biosphere you guys have understood. There are four things which we guys have seen. Atmosphere we have seen, lithosphere we have seen, hydrosphere also we have seen. I hope you guys understood from this particular picture. Now, interaction between different components of environment. When it comes to the interaction, if we want to interact with different components of environment, there are so many things that we can discuss here. There are so many things that we can see here. Again, as I told you in previous slide, we have seen these contents. We have seen biosphere, atmosphere also we have seen, lithosphere also we have seen, and hydrosphere also we have seen. So these are the interactive components of environment, and without these components of environment is not complete or possible as such. So now we are going to talk about physical environment. What does it mean and how it is possible? So see, as far as physical life processes and systems, when it comes to life processes and systems, there are three types of things that we can see, or three types of environments that we can see. The first one, physical environment. Physical means what? That we can see around us. Oh my gosh. That we can see around us, like in the form of plant, in the form of land, in the form of animals and all, those can be called as, in the form of rivers, seas and all, those can be called as physical environment. When it comes to biological environment, whatever biological aspects, biological things that we can see around us, those can be called as biological environment. And the last but not least, if we see, we can see some chemicals around us, and those can be called as chemical environment. So, as a part of our life processes and systems, there are three types of environments that we can see. The first one is physical environment, second one is biological environment, and third one is chemical environment. If I'm not wrong, you guys have understood. There are three major elements, there are three major components of physical environment, sorry, components of life processes and systems. And those three are physical, biological, and chemical. I hope you guys have understood this. Now, we are going to talk about one more thing here, and here we can have something different. Man and environment relationship. As I told you, we are the part and parcel of this environment because we come under the category of biological environment. We come under the category of lithosphere. So man and environment, there is one particular relationship. If we want to understand this particular relationship between man and environment, we need to understand something. So this is what it is necessary. Let me see how many of you are there. Very good. There are 31 people including me. So 30 people they have joined. Thank you very much for joining in, a little bit good number. Keep it up. So just, I'm going to share it again. So see, we are going to understand the concept, understand the relationship between man and environment. What sort of relationship is there, or what sort of relation is there between man and environment? We cannot, take away man from the environment, or we cannot take environment from the man. This is the things. Both are interlinked, both are correlated, and there is a very strong relationship between man and environment. We cannot see man without environment. We cannot see environment without man, because both are the part of each other, parcel of part and parcel of each other, if I'm not wrong. So we are going to understand how it is related, how both are related with each other by looking at these points. So first one is what? Man is the only living organism capable of modifying environment according to the need. So see, when we think about the brilliant and the intellectual person on the planet Earth is none other than man. And man is having this capacity of, modifying the environment according to the need. And we have modified according to our need, and we have a number of examples of that. So man is the only animal on this planet Earth who is using the Earth and who is using the environment according to the requirement, according to the need. And this is what they have said like this. Man has started hunting animals and cutting trees for his basic needs. This one is a history, as we know that. people or man is the only animal on the planet Earth who is, you know, hunting animals for their food purpose. As we guys have seen that even we cut trees for our basic needs purpose. And this kind of relationship is there between the man and the environment. Then next one is to increase his comforts. He started distributing each and every components of the environment. Basically, man is a very brilliant person, as I told you. This one is the only intellectual person on the planet Earth, or the human being on the planet Earth, no doubt at all. And man means we people have started making comfort by using different components of the environment. Then large-scale deforestation, increasing in quantity of CO2 due to burning of forest, grass, crop, waste, are example of early cause of pollution. As we know that we people have started doing deforestation or deforesting, and because of this kind of deforesting, the number of or the quantity of CO2, that is carbon dioxide, is increasing in the environment. And there are a number of reasons, like we start burning the forest, then we start burning the grass, we start burning the crop. So a number of reasons are there. And deforesting is the main reason of increasing in CO2. So this kind of relationship is there between the man and the environment. Other points also we are going to see in days to come, or in days to, or in upcoming lectures that are scheduled. Now we are going to see what sort of impact of technology on environment is there. As we know that we all are very techno-savvy, we are using technology for different purposes, and we cannot imagine our life without technology. We know that. And everywhere technology is important, and whatever lectures I'm taking for you all just now, that is because of the technology. Just imagine if technology weren't there, or if it is not there, what will happen? So there are a number of things, a number of reasons of using technology. But there are certain positive, certain negative, certain, you know, direct or indirect impacts of technologies on environments are there, those we are discussing here. So there are three types of impacts we are going to see. We are going to talk about positive environment, we are going to talk about positive impact. Similarly, we are going to talk about negative impact, and we are going to talk about direct and indirect impact of technology on environment. So when it comes to positive impact of technology on environment is concerned, so look at the first one, positive impact one. Waste treatment plants to reduce the pollution. As we know that we are trying to go for reducing the pollution, as we know that pollution is increasing day by day, and Delhi is the most polluted country in our country, or in our India. So we are trying to reduce the pollution, and if we want to go for this one, technology is useful to waste management or waste treatment management. And by using technology, we can definitely manage our waste that we get from our houses and you know, from industry area also. Then electricity generation option is the source of using those waste, and if we use those things, definitely we can generate some energy. And this one is a positive impact as such. Uses of biofuels, then biofuels also we are using, and those can be created by using technology. So this one is the only aspect, or this one is, these are the impacts which can be called as positive impacts of technology on environment. After that, we are going to talk about positive effects. What sort of positive effects are there of technology? Then water treatment plants help us to reuse of dirty water. There are certain water treatment plants which are useful to convert dirty water into usable water, or good water, or fine water for all of us. So technology we are using to convert dirty water into good water, or usable water, or drinkable water. Then wind turbines helps to reduce the needs of coal, electric, and other natural resources. Whatever, you know, resources we use for the purpose of energy, like coal, electric, and other natural resources. And instead of that, we are using technology, and we are trying to convert wind into the energy. This one is a good impact of or positive impact of technology, and by using this technology we are creating electricity to improve lifestyle and safety of human life, we as well as improve the environment of this planet of the future. We are also using technology to improve our lifestyle, even the lifestyle of human being, and this way it is possible. The science of sewage treatment is probably the greatest environmental achievement of mankind, and we are trying to go for sewage treatment, and there is a science behind that. What sort of science in there? And also we know that, and if we achieve that, that will be the greatest achievement of mankind if we try to get a science of sewage treatment. Now we are moving on the next point, and here we are going to talk about impact of technology on environment. And now we are going to talk about negative impacts. There are certain negative impacts also. As I told you, there are two sides for every coin. So here also first side we have seen, and that was positive side. And now we are talking about negative side, which is called as negative effects. The negative effects are further divided. Negative effects are further divided into direct and indirect. So whatever negative impacts we are going to see, those are classified into two different subcategories, and those are direct effects and indirect effects. When it comes to direct effects, the first one is what? Accidents in various industries. As we know that accidents have taken place, no doubt we are using technologies in our life and even in industries also. No doubt technology is useful for our life, but up to some extent that is okay. And because of technology, a number of things are happening which are not good for the human being, which are not good for the we people. And one of the causes is that accidents are taking place because of the technology. Then nuclear pollution is also increasing because of technology, as we know that. Now we are going to see the another sub point of this negative impacts, that is indirect impacts. What sort of indirect impacts are happening? The first one is what? Uses of fossil fuels causes air pollution. And we guys are using fuels, that is fossil fuel. And because of that, air pollution is taking place. Then we can see the greenhouse effects also. In acid rain, we are experiencing global warming also, we guys are experiencing. And because of global warming, a number of things are happening. So this is the fact that we can see as far as indirect effects are concerned. Now the negative impacts we are going to see. If you want to understand what sort of negative impacts or negative effects are there, the first one, that is direct effect, it includes accidents, release of pollutants affecting human health, exhaustion of resources, and changes in the landscapes. So these are the direct effects which we can see directly by looking around us. Accidents are happening, then pollutants are affecting on human health, then exhaustion of resources are going to exhaust one day, and changes of landscape are also happening. Then indirect effects that we can see here, certain indirect effects are there. They are like these effects interface with the vital services supplied to humanity by the natural ecological system, and that we cannot realize, but it is going to happen or it is happening. So these are the negative effects of technology which we are using in day-to-day life. Next one, that is environmental degradation. No doubt degradation is taking place, and people are hampering the nature, and when nature is being hampered, automatically environment degradation is there, or environmental degradation is taking place. So first of all, we are going to understand the concept of environmental degradation. What is that? The overall lowering of environmental qualities due to the damages caused by both natural event and human activities in the basic structure of the environment of at local, regional and global levels, adversely affecting all living organisms, including man. So here what they have said, environmental degradation is what? Environmental degradation is nothing but what? It is happening because of two reasons. One is natural events like flood, then heavy rainfall, and number of things are there in natural calamities, we can say. And another reason is what? Human activities that we are doing, and we are trying to change the structure of environment. We are trying to make some necessary developments on the planet Earth, and because of that, environmental degradation is taking place. So because of these two reasons, one is natural reason and another one is artificial reason, we can call it, because it is going to be made by the human beings or human because of the human activities. So this is what, when we do something wrong with the nature, when we do something wrong with the environment, it becomes environmental degradation automatically. So this is the concept of environmental degradation, and we always do that. We cut trees, we construct houses, we cut trees and we construct houses. So instead of planting trees, we are cutting the trees and constructing cement jungle like that. Then environmental degradation arises due to, because of the below reasons, environmental degradation is taking place. Consumption of natural resources by overpopulation of developing countries. As we know that these developing countries or developed countries, they are consuming natural resources in a very, very, excessive or massive manner, and that is not good. And because of that, we can damage the nature, we can damage the environment. Wasteful overconsumption of resources by developed countries, as well as developed countries, they are also using, they are going for overconsumption of resources, which is not good. As I told you, these resources are going to end one day, and that day is no longer, will come very soon, where we have cars and all, but we don't have fuel to run the car on the road. So that day, you guys have to think about, and if you think about it in a very precise manner, you will wake up. If you wake up and understand the importance of natural resources on the planet Earth, and this is what I told you, we can have to save these resources for our upcoming generations. If we do not save them, we do not save those resources, definitely our future generation will definitely blame us, and they will say our past, our forefathers, they haven't kept anything else for us. So this is what we need to keep, we need to preserve, we need to protect these resources for our future generations. So this is environmental science, which we are going to see. When it comes to environmental sciences, it is interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary field, drawing on many diverse disciplines. Environmental science is a science where we consider a number of diverse disciplines, such as ecology, biology, chemistry, atmospheric science, oceanography, geology, archaeology, anthropology, sociology, history, political science, engineering, economics, ethics. So environmental science is not a small subject. It is not a science only. It is a number of things which are included. Here we have seen what is that. It is a very diverse field, diverse disciplines are included in that. Just now, as we have seen. So environmental science is nothing but what? It is a very, very broad concept, not a narrow concept as such. I hope you guys have understood this. Now we are going to talk about multidisciplinary nature of the environment studies. So how it is different, how it is called as multidisciplinary nature of the environment studies. So these and other points we are going to see in tomorrow's session. My lecture is going to end at it is 1:20. I started my lecture at 12:40 sharp, and I exhaust my time, no issue at all. So I'm getting back to the home screen by stopping my presentation. I hope you guys have understood this. And what I'm going to tell you, friends, so this was my second session. And after this, I don't have any session as such. I hope you guys have understood whatever I taught you today. Tomorrow also we are going to see something different, whatever topics are sent to me. And I'll try to deliver, good content about that one. So be there for tomorrow's session also. The link that I have shared for today will be there for upcoming 10 days or 15 days. Till 6. But I will share you the timing of my session. Okay. So be there and enjoy your life or enjoy my lectures. Thank you very much. If you would like to ask some questions, you can. Before that, let me stop the recording.